Well, happy Thursday. I have an appointment this morning, so I'm in the truck, but don't worry, I'm parked safely. I've been struggling the last few days with things that have been kind of my nemesis, a couple of my nemesis my whole life, self-pity and bitterness. And those have kind of, they just keep coming in back in my life. And it gets frustrating as Christians because sometimes we have the sense that we become redeemed and then we become perfect or move towards perfection. The problem is Christ didn't save us because we've changed or got better. He doesn't stay in our lives because of that either. We always have the old nature. Luther said the old Adam and Eve grabbing at our necks, trying to strangle us and block out faith in God. Somehow get us to go away and leave Christ and so forth. Well, anyway, we're always tempted by the flesh still lives. We are still sinners in need of daily repentance. And just the self-pity and the bitterness in my life, I'm very disappointed. They should have been gone by now, but I keep wrestling with them. One thing that these things do, this fight against the flesh and things that kind of obsess us or hurt us because of their sinful, what they do remind us of is that we need to be humble. We need to be humble. We can't be proud. Left to ourselves, we would fail. God is in us. He accepts us as we are, but he doesn't leave us as we are. He seeks to bring us forward to serve him, to become more Christ-like and so forth. John chapter 6. Verse 35, Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. He's already told the woman at the well that he's the living waters. He's the water, now he's the bread. He is everything we need spiritually. John is always using physical accounts, actual accounts, historical accounts in order to press the point of who Jesus Christ is. He's bread, he's water, he's life, spiritually speaking. Who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. Some Christians, and even Lutherans too, have a difficulty with the thought that he comes to me, that we come to Christ. And actually, it feels like we come to Christ psychologically, but we're going to read on and learn exactly what that draw is. All that the Father gives me will come to me. That is, people. All whom the Father gives to me will come to me. Do you see that? The coming isn't just our volition. The coming is that Jesus Christ opens our eyes and does some work in us to draw us. For I've come down from heaven not to do my will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of the one who sent me, that I lose none of all that he has given me, but raise them up in the last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I'll raise them on the last day. So everyone who looks to the Son gets eternal life. Seeing and not seeing is throughout the whole gospel. And looks to is like see, right? I mean, John at the tomb, he sees and he believes, even though all they see is the grave cloth. And then Mary in the garden sees Jesus and comes to faith in him, his Messiah, his risen Lord Jesus Christ. So everyone who looks to the Son and believes in me shall have eternal life. Chapter 9 coming up is a story of Jesus healing a blind man. At the end of the story, he heals his spiritual blindness. People are blind and dead, and they cannot come to Christ on their own. They need help. At this, the Jews began to grumble. And because he said, I'm the bread of heaven, come down, I'm the bread, come down from heaven. They said, is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he say, I came down from heaven? Stop grumbling among yourselves, Jesus answered. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. There it is. It shows the passiveness of faith. No one can come to the Father. No one can come to Jesus. No one can come to Jesus except those whom the Father draws. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. Through the Word of God, remember in the beginning was the Word was with God. It starts off the gospel with the Word of God. And all the way through the Gospels, it's the Word. As the Word is heard and encountered, the Spirit of God draws people to faith. No one can come to me unless the Father draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, they will all be taught by God. Everyone who listens to the Father and learns from him comes to me. No one has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Only he has seen the Father. You notice, too, that it says the Father. Jesus says the Father or our Father over 120 times in his gospel. Always capital F, but never referring to him as our Father, except the last one. We'll get to that, of course, much later. I tell you the truth, he who believes has everlasting life. It's not he who works, it's he who believes. There's a little confusion about that, of course, in yesterday's text, when Jesus said, you know, work for things that endure. Well, he didn't mean our works save us, and that's clarified here. He who believes has eternal life. It's those who believe, repent and believe, not those who work and do. I'm the bread of life. Your forefathers ate manna in the desert, and they died. But here's the bread that comes down from heaven, which a man may eat and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. The Holy Spirit's in the Gospels more than we see. Many times the Holy Spirit's not mentioned because the Holy Spirit's goal is to glorify Jesus Christ. Road to Emmaus, their eyes were open, they recognized him. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. It doesn't say the Holy Spirit. And here, the Father draws. Well, that's the Holy Spirit's work, drawing people, inspiring people, stirring people through God's word. Jesus Christ, again and again, is portrayed as the one who has the power to give eternal life to those who believe. It's not by works. It's not by effort. It's not by our resume. Our resume is worthless, worse than worthless. You don't have anything on the page before God. So he comes and dies on the cross, and in that we become his children, and in that we are saved. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. I pray for all of us who are listening. Use us this week. Stir us to deeper affections for you. I pray for those who are listening who are feeling like you're not close and feeling like they've done too much wrong to be forgiven by you. Show them and stir them into the belief of the truth that you love them and that you're present even when it doesn't look like it. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great Thursday and glorify Jesus today. Ciao.